Have you ever wondered why we were created in the image of God? Does God have a plan? Does God have a purpose? What is the reason why the Bible says that we are created in the image of God? I really think that to answer that question, you have to go no further than the book of Genesis and read that statement that God gave to those first two people who were created in His image, and that is Adam and Eve. The Bible tells us that God said to Adam and Eve to be fruitful and multiply and replenish the earth and subdue it and have dominion over the fish of the sea and over the fowl of the air and over every creeping thing that creeps upon the face of the earth. I believe the Bible is saying that God had created Adam and Eve in His image, not simply for them to be tenants in paradise, but for them to be rulers over God's created world. If you heard that, say amen. To be rulers over God's created world. King Solomon saw something in his day that he said was a very strange thing. He said in the book of Ecclesiastes, chapter number 10, that when I looked around, he said, I saw servants that were riding on horses, and I saw princes that were walking on the earth like servants. And Solomon said, that's a very strange thing, because princes were made to ride and servants were made to walk. And as I think about those verses, I say, you know what? We really can apply that to our day and time right now. Because as I look around, especially in the Christian culture, I see that so many times there are things that are ruling over us rather than us ruling over them. And the Bible very clearly teaches that God has created us to be kings. Jesus Christ has redeemed us to be kings. The Holy Spirit has empowered us to be kings. And yet so many of us that God desires for us to be kings, we are not. We are being ruled over rather than being rulers. And I really think that it's high time for God's people to rise up and to claim by faith God's will for each of our lives. And that is to live like the kings God created us to be, like the kings Christ redeemed us to be, and like the kings that the Holy Spirit empowers us to be. And that is why today I want to begin a brand new series, and the title of my series is King Material. Now, you know, if we're going to be like kings, if we're going to live like kings, we need an example to follow. And the example that we're going to be following over the next several weeks is the example that's found in the life of the greatest king in the Word of God, and that is King David. It really would do us well to do a study of the life of King David. Did you know that apart from the Lord Jesus Christ, that there is no other character in the Bible that is mentioned more than King David? For example, 14 chapters are devoted to the life of Abraham and Joseph. 11 chapters are devoted to the life of Jacob. 10 chapters are devoted to the life of Elijah. But 66 chapters in the Word of God are devoted to the life of David. And not only that, there are 59 references, if I counted correctly, in the New Testament to David. Now, evidently, there is something about the life of David that God wants us to learn. Something there that God wants us to emulate. And if we are going to learn how to live like kings, I really do not know of a greater example than the life of King David. So I want to tell you this morning, the world needs and the church needs us to start living like kings. The Russian poet Boris Pasternak said, and I quote, "It is not revolutions and upheavals that clear the road to new and better days, but someone's soul that is inspired and ablaze." I love the quote of that poem. That's what clears the road for new and better days, someone's soul that is inspired and is ablaze. And I really believe that that is an accurate description of a Christian who is living like a king. And this morning I want to talk to us on the subject of the calling of a king. And I invite you to open your Bibles to 1 Samuel chapter number 16. 1 Samuel chapter number 16, we're going to read together these first 13 verses and then come back and learn some principles today on how we can live like kings. 1 Samuel chapter 16, the Bible says in verse 1, "And the Lord said unto Samuel, How long wilt thou mourn for Saul, seeing that I have rejected him from reigning over Israel? Fill thine horn with oil and go, and I will send thee to Jesse the Bethlehemite, for I have provided me a king among his sons. And Samuel said, how can I go? If Saul hear it, he will kill me. And the Lord said, take an heifer with thee, and say that I am come to sacrifice to the Lord. And call Jesse to the sacrifice, and I will show thee what thou shalt do. And thou shalt anoint unto me him whom I name unto thee. So Samuel did that which the Lord spake, and came to Bethlehem. And the elders of the town trembled at his coming, and said, comest thou peaceably? And he said, peaceably, I am come to sacrifice unto the Lord. Sanctify yourselves, and come with me to the sacrifice. And he sanctified Jesse and his sons, and called them to the sacrifice. And it came to pass that when they were come, that he looked on Eliab, and said, surely the Lord's anointed is before him. But the Lord said unto Samuel, look not on his countenance, or on the height of his stature. That's good news for me. Because I have refused him. For the Lord seeth not as man seeth, for man looketh on the outward appearance, but the Lord looketh on the heart. We read that, but do we really believe that? And Jesse called Abinadab and made him pass before Samuel. And he said, neither hath the Lord chosen this one. And Jesse made Shema to pass by. And he said, neither hath the Lord chosen this one. And again Jesse made seven of his sons to pass before Samuel. And Samuel said unto Jesse, the Lord hath not chosen these. And Samuel said unto Jesse, are all thy children here? And he said, there remaineth yet the youngest, and behold, he keepeth the sheep. And Samuel said unto Jesse, send and fetch him, for we will not sit down till he come hither. And he sent and he brought him in. Now he was ruddy and withal of a beautiful countenance, which just really means he was a little red-headed boy. And he was goodly to look upon. And the Lord said, arise and anoint him, for this is he. Now let's just kind of gather our thoughts around three main points today. Number one is the search of a king. And if we're going to understand about this search for the king, that in verse number one, the Bible says God sent Samuel to this particular place to look for a king, we need to understand something about the historical background of the day in which King David was born. Now we know when we study Bible history, we know that about 40 years before David was inaugurated as king, we know that the period of the judges had come to an end. And the period of the judges was really a bad time. It was a period of time in which the Bible says that every man was doing what was right in his own eyes. And during that particular period of time, the nation of Israel had reached a point where spiritual and moral decay was prevalent in the land. In fact, for five centuries, a state of lawlessness had literally overwhelmed the nation of Israel. I mean, it was in bad, bad shape. I remember reading a book one time, a book by G. Frederick Owen, and it was a book that was entitled From Abraham to the Middle East Crisis. And in that book, there was a particular sentence, a statement that the author made that I believe accurately described the condition of Israel of that day. He said that they were on a long drift from God. In other words, they were not close to God. They were far from the heart of God. They were not living in obedience to the will and the word of God. And all of that, I believe, is what precipitated this search for a new king that we read about in chapter number 16. Now, as we think about the search for the new king, we need to understand something about, first of all, the reigning king. And the reigning king, obviously, his name was Saul. And I started to go back and do my first sermon in this series out of chapter 15 that talks about the downfall of this king, because it is an interesting story to read indeed. Now you remember that after the period of the judges, the Bible says that the people of Israel, they rose up and they were demanding a king. Now, they were not demanding a king simply because they wanted a spiritual leader. That was the last thing that was on their mind. But they were demanding a king because all of the other nations around them, they had a king. And so they just wanted to be like all of the other nations. You know, there is something about human nature, isn't there, that wants to be like everybody else. You know, human nature has not changed over the years. And so they rose up, they demanded a king, they wanted a king. And dear friend, when they got what they wanted, they did not want what they had gotten. And so many times that's just like us. We think we want something, and that is outside of the will of God. And then once we get it, we learn that, you know what? I really do not want what I have gotten. So they demanded a king, and Saul was the winner of the People's Choice Award. Now, when you look at King Saul, he had all of the qualities, I mean all of the necessary qualities by which the world uses to choose a king. The Bible says of Saul that he was tall, he was dark, and he was handsome. I mean, he had all of the external qualities. In fact, if the nation of Israel would have been a used car lot, Saul would have been the shiniest model on that lot. I mean, there were so many things about Saul that attracted the people to him to say, you know what, we want this guy to be our king. But dear friend, we're going to learn something important today. We're going to learn that God does not choose kings the way that the world chooses kings. We're going to learn that the way that the world chooses people is usually based on externals, and yet the way that God chooses people is always based on internals. I mean, Saul had every external quality that anyone could possibly want. I mean, he was the Phi Beta Kappa, the beauty queen, the all-American gorilla fullback, all wrapped up in one. And yet the Bible says there was something wrong with him because he had a rotten heart. His heart wasn't right with God. And so when God began to look for a king, he said, I have some different qualities that I'm going to be looking for. Friend, I want to tell you the first lesson we learn from that is sometimes what appears to be is not in reality what is. I've often thought that sometimes that those who appear to be the most righteous really are not. And sometimes that person that is hidden in obscurity, that no one notices, that no one pays much attention to, maybe that's the most righteous person there is. Oh, how convicting that this study is to realize that God is focused on the internals and not the externals. So for the search of a king, the reigning king was Saul, and this reigning king became a rejected king. That's why they needed a new king. Back in chapter 15, verse number 26, the Bible says why it was that God rejected Saul from being king. In verse 26 of the 15th chapter, it says that Samuel said unto Saul, I will not return with thee, for thou hast rejected the word of the Lord, and the Lord hath rejected thee from being king over Israel. You see, the people were living in great misery because their leader was living in rebellion against the word of God. Now, friend, I want us to hear and hear clearly. There is no way that we will ever live like kings if we reject the word of the Lord. And the Bible tells us in Proverbs chapter 29 and verse number 2 that when the righteous rule, that the people rejoice. But when the wicked rule, that the people live in misery. And you see, dear friend, that can apply to nations, to the leadership of nations. That can apply to families, to the leadership of the home, the man of the house, and that can provide, that can apply also to churches with the spiritual leader of a church. And so when the righteous rule, the people rejoice, but when the leader rejects the word of God, then God says, I've got to raise somebody else up to be that leader. And so this reigning king became the rejected king. Not only do we see here the search for the king, but we also see the selection of a king. Now, here's where it gets interesting, because what we're about to learn here, we're going to learn how God chooses people to be kings. And we're going to learn the kinds of people that God chooses to use. What kind of people does God choose to use? Will God just use any old lug that comes rolling along? Or does God have some characteristics? Are there some qualities there that God looks for? I think we learn a couple important things here. First of all, we learn the place of God's choosing. down in verse number 4 of the Bible, and we wouldn't just pick up on this in a casual reading. In verse 4, it says that Samuel did that which the Lord spake, and he came to Bethlehem. So God sent him to Bethlehem to select the new king. Do you realize that the Bethlehem of that day is not anything like the Bethlehem of our day that we know about and we read about? As a matter of fact, the Bethlehem of that day was a very small and insignificant place. The Bethlehem of that day was nothing important at all. The Bethlehem of that day was so small that it's not even listed in the cities of Judah that are chronicled in the book of Joshua. You'll not even find it mentioned there. And yet the principle there is that smallness never hinders greatness. And so God sent him to Bethlehem, this insignificant place that would one day become very significant. Because Bethlehem, that was the place where Rachel gave birth to Benjamin. It was the place where Boaz courted and married the great-grandmother of David, the lady by the name of Ruth. And most importantly, it became the place where our Lord was born. As a matter of fact, Bethlehem probably occupies a position of prominence in the music that we sing at Christmas more than any other place in the world. But at that time, it was a very small and it was a very insignificant place. Now, to me, that registers as being very important that God would choose to go to Bethlehem and find the youngest of Jesse's sons and take this nobody that nobody noticed from nowhere and anoint him to be the next king of Israel. Why did God do that? Because that seems to be the way that God chooses to do things. We need to hear 1 Corinthians chapter 1. One of the most powerful words in the Bible is the word many. It says, "For you see your calling, brethren, how that not many wise men after the flesh are chosen, not many mighty men, not many noble are called. But God hath chosen those foolish things, those that no one else notices, to confound the wise. God has chosen the weak things of the world to confound the things that are mighty, the base things, those things of low degree. God hath chosen those despised things, things which are not, to bring to naught things that are. Why? So that no flesh should glory in his presence." I'll guarantee you that everybody in Israel would have said to God, go and find Saul's twin brother. Go find somebody just like him. And God said, I'm looking for somebody that when I choose them, you would never think that I would choose somebody and use somebody such as that. Though David, like Bethlehem, was small and insignificant, that did not hinder him from God using him to develop into spiritual greatness. Now, dear friend, you may be a Bethlehem in the eyes of the world. You may be a nobody that nobody notices in a nowhere place. But I want to tell you, based on the authority of the Word of God, that cannot hinder you from living like a king. You don't have to be a somebody. You don't have to be a big shot. You don't have to be the most intelligent person in the world. You don't have to be the most wealthy person in the world, because that's not what God looks at when he calls people. So we see the place of the choosing, but we also see the person of the choosing. And I'm not going to read these verses again in verses 5 through 13, but I'll make reference to them in just a moment. But let me just stop and say right here, when God scans this audience for potential kings, and God looks up in the balcony, and God looks down here on the main floor, and God looks back here in the choir, when God looks in this audience and scans it, friend, he's not looking for angels in the flesh. He's not looking for perfect people, because there are none. But friend, there are some qualities that God's looking for, and he will not bypass those qualities. Thanks be unto God that God does not grade us like the world does. Friend, God does not grade us by the inches of our waist, or by the square footage of our house, or by the name of our clothing, or by the presence of our degrees, or by the size of our office, or by the color of our skin. God doesn't grade us based on any of that, but there is something God does look for. I mean, why is it that God just completely dismissed and overlooked the seven sons of Jesse and chose the run of the litter, the tag-along of the family, the one that his daddy felt like he was so unimportant, he didn't even invite him for Samuel to look at? Why is that? It was because God saw something in David. I think that verse number 7 gives us an idea here. When it says, "But the Lord said unto Samuel, look not on his countenance or on the height of his stature, because I have refused him. For the Lord seeth not as man seeth. For man looketh on the outward appearance, but the Lord looketh on the heart." God saw something in David's heart that he did not see in those other brothers. 2 Chronicles chapter 16, verse 9, the Bible says, "For the eyes of the Lord run to and fro throughout the earth to show himself strong in behalf of them whose heart is perfect toward him." God's the great interior decorator. God is the one who notices what is on the inside. Dear friend, when God measures us for spiritual greatness, he does not put the tape around our head. He puts the tape around our heart. What interests God is what is on the inside, not what is on the outside. Friend, David was not a perfect man. As a matter of fact, most of us remember David for his two glaring weaknesses, murder and adultery. That's the two things that we remember most about David. He was not a perfect man, but something is said about David that is said about no other character in the Bible, and that is that he had a heart for God. As a matter of fact, two times in Scripture, the Bible says he was a man after God's own heart. Here was an adulterer and here was a murderer. And yet there was some kind of a spiritual reality that was in his heart that God saw and that God picked up on. Friend, what does the Bible mean when it talks about the heart? You know, the heart's a lot more than valves and ventricles and veins. But the heart's who we are on the inside. The heart is something you can't see about me and I can't see about you. The heart is the spiritual epicenter of our life. The heart is that place where we discern and we desire and we decide and we devote. That's the heart. And the Bible says that when God looked into David's heart, that he saw something there that he said, "Now here is king material." You know, I want to ask you the question, what kind of heart did David have? I want to mention several things, and I want to tell you, if we'll have a heart like this, then we'll live like kings and God will use us. Number one is he had a faithful heart. Over in Psalm 78. Psalm 78, you can turn there with me if you'd like, or just listen as I read it to you. But Psalm 78, it tells us something about the heart of King David. Psalm 78, verse number 70. Now mark these words. Verse 70, he chose David also a servant, and he took him from the sheepfolds. He took him from following the ewes, great with young. He brought him to feed Jacob, his people, and Israel, his inheritance. So he fed them according to the integrity of his heart, and guided them by the skillfulness of his hands. You know what God did? God looked down and God saw something in this young boy's heart. And he said, I'm going to elevate this guy. And he used him because he promoted him from the lesser to the greater, from serving sheep to serving the people of God. And here in this psalm is the real deal as to why David was such a great man. Do you realize that David's greatness is not seen in his killing of Goliath? If I were to ask you today, find a passage of Scripture that describes the greatness of David, you would probably go to 1 Samuel 17, where he took out that giant that no one else could kill. Friend, his greatness was not determined by him killing Goliath, but his greatness was determined by this fella being faithful in the lesser things of life. Here was a guy that was faithful over few things, and so God made him ruler over many things. See, that's a real issue in turning into someone that's a spiritual giant, living like a king, being used by God. It is just to be faithful where we are in the small things of life. And yet so many people never are used mightily of God because they are not willing to be faithful in the smaller things of life. There are those who want to be teachers, and yet they won't even be faithful to be a tither. They want to handle God's word, and yet they mishandle God's money. And they say, why would God not elevate me to that position and use me like that? It's because we're not faithful in the small things. Friend, if you do not get anything else, get this today. Until you are faithful in the small things to do what you know the Word of God and the will of God teaches, until you're faithful there, God's not going to take you elsewhere. Verse 72 is an amazing verse. It says, so he fed them according to the integrity of his heart. You know what that means? That means that David was faithful when no one was looking. The integrity of his heart. Would you not agree that being a shepherd out in the fields like David was, that was an isolated position? That was a position of obscurity? That was a position where no one noticed what he was doing, and yet the Bible says that he was faithful. I want to ask us today, are you listening? Say amen. Are we as faithful in private as we are in public? Unless we can say yes to that question, we're not going to live like kings. When no one else is looking, when we are not in the audience of the church, when we're not surrounded by people, are we just as faithful in private as we are in public? What do we watch on television when no one else is around? What do we read in the magazine when no one knows? What occupies our attention when we are there in solitude? Friend, I want to tell you, obscurity is the preparing ground for kingship. And until we conquer that, obscurity has a way of preparing us to receive the applause of popularity in a way that we will not use it in a sinful way. And I believe that when the Lord looked out, man, he saw this young guy who had been so faithful when nobody else was around. You see, friend, what is important, what really is important, is not what you think about me. It's what God knows about me. It's what God sees when I'm in private and not when I'm out here publicly. What was the key to him being a man after God's own heart? Man, he had a faithful heart. Secondly, he had a humble heart. I believe that David learned the lesson that Simon Peter would write about years later. When Simon Peter said to humble yourselves under the mighty hand of God, and he will exalt you in due season. Now, how do we see the humility of David in 1 Samuel chapter 16? Let me ask you, what did David do immediately after he was anointed as king? Look in verse 19. Verse 19 says, wherefore Saul sent messengers unto Jesse and said, send me David thy son, which is with the sheep. That's almost an afterthought. Do we understand that this is a 16-year-old boy who has just been told by God, you're the king of Israel, son? What did he do? He didn't go down to the mall to try on crowns. He didn't go have some business cards printed up that said, king-elect. He didn't detail his chariot and ride through the streets shouting out, I'm the new sheriff in town. He went back to stinking sheep. talking about humility. The great Jonathan Edwards says that the greatest protection that we have against Satan and his schemes is a humble heart. The greatest protection we have against Satan and his schemes is a humble heart. Now, friend, I want to tell us, listen, the person that always seeks the applause, always seeks the recognition, always seeks the limelight, will never live like a king, because we live like kings for one reason, and that's the applause to go to the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, and not unto ourselves. He had a humble heart. Do you realize that if we read this chronology through, that it was 14 years after he was anointed before he was crowned? I believe that he had to learn to walk in humility before he was ever worthy to wear the crown. Let me ask you, have you already been anointed? You've been saved, but you've never been crowned as a leader? Why? Could you need to ask yourself the question, do I have a humble heart? God has to teach all of us humility. I remember when I was called to preach that my hero, and he still is, was Dr. Charles Stanley. Man, I listened to all of his sermons, read all of his books. His book, Handle with Prayer, changed my life. But I remember thinking the same week that I got saved, at any time now, I'm going to receive a call from First Baptist Church in Atlanta. When they hear that I have surrendered to preach, they're just going to say, slide on over, Dr. Stanley. Craig Connor's the new competition in town. Well, the call never came. I went to Bible college, and my first title, my first ministerial position, was a multi-titled position. I was the church outreach director, minister of education, and janitor, all wrapped up in one. As I was stripping those floors, God was stripping my pride. And my first church that I was the pastor of, it didn't seat over 2,000 people like this one. It barely seated 125. And it wasn't a quarter of the way full when I got there. Stripping me of my pride. And I had to learn an important lesson in life. We will never be elevated until we are deflated. As long as we are full of ourselves. Friend, I want to tell you what, if your own interest is just tooting your own horn, you will never make any music in the kingdom of God. Pride goeth before destruction, a haughty spirit before a fall. Pride is such a horrible thing, and God used this guy because he had a faithful heart, because he had a humble heart, because he had a serving heart, a serving heart. David served the sheep. David served his father, and David even served his enemy, King Saul. I want to tell you what the preparatory ground for kingship is. It's servanthood. Servanthood. We serve our way into kingship because we are never more like Jesus than when we are serving. Jesus said, I have not come to be served, but to serve, and to give my life a ransom for many. And so if we really want to live like kings, and friends, we ought to want to live like that. The glory of God emanating from our lives. If we really want to live like kings, we'll prepare ourselves for that by being servants. What are we doing for Jesus today? What position of service do you have today? You say, oh, it's unimportant. No, it's not. If it's something you're doing for the kingdom's sake, it's vitally, vitally, vitally important. And God will take you where you are, and he will elevate you to a greater responsibility in life. When we're faithful where we are to the responsibility God's given us, then God will give us greater responsibility in life. He had a faithful heart, a humble heart, a serving heart. Friend, you know what I see every time somebody walks down this aisle and says yes to Jesus? I see a king in waiting. Every time, a king in waiting. Every time I see potential for great spiritual greatness. Friend, don't die as a king in waiting. Take advantage of the opportunities that are before you. Wouldn't it be tragic never to get crowned before we got called home? Don't live as a king in waiting. Seize the opportunity and be all you can be for the glory of God. He had a worshiping heart. No one would disagree who knows their Bibles that David was probably the greatest worshiper in the Word of God. Just read the Psalms. As he cries out, as the deer pants after the water brooks, even so my soul thirsteth after thee, O God, for the living God. And I believe that King David's greatest highs were produced by his greatest lows, where he drew from a strength that he gained from having a worshiping heart. What does it mean to have a worshiping heart? It means to know God. Not just know about God, but truly know God. That's a worshiping heart. But he also had a forgiven heart. A forgiven heart. I said earlier that the two things that we remember David the most for were his murder and his adultery. But dear friend, I want to remind us today that David came clean with God. He really did. And when David came clean with God, God forgave him, God cleansed him, God restored him, and God used him. When I think about the life of David, I can almost see it in my mind's eye. Here is David, his life is a wreck. He hands to God the broken heart, and God takes that broken heart and he puts the pieces of a wounded soul back together again. Friend, I want to tell you, you can bring a wounded, ruined, wrecked, shattered life, put it in the hand of God, and you will see an omnipotent God of grace go to work and put all the pieces back together. God does not use perfect people, but God does use forgiven people. Friend, I don't care what you've done, where you've been. I don't care about any of that stuff. I'm telling you, it will not disqualify you from living like a king for the glory of God. So we see the search for a king. We see the selection of a king. And we also see the seminar of a king. I think that as we sit down in David's classroom, that David teaches a seminar. And it's a seminar that focuses on one thing. The human heart. The human heart. And through David's experience, we learn three things about God and the human heart. Number one is God examines the heart. Now, friend, listen carefully. We tend to not want to think too clearly about this. All of us, we tend to be like the Pharisees. And we focus on the externals and on the appearance. But God doesn't do that. God examines the heart. Friends, the heart is important. Jesus said, out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. Jesus said, out of the abundance of the heart, all of these things flow. And he just gives us a whole litany of ugly things. It's the heart that counts. A frightening thought, a sobering thought, is to walk in, sit down in church, and honestly believe God knows what's going on in my heart right now. God knows it. God's looking at every heart on these pews. God's looking at this heart in this pulpit. God knows my motivation for being up here to preach this sermon today. God knows whether I really love him or I'm just up here performing. God knows if I'm interested in developing my fellowship with him. God knows whether or not I want to receive the applause of men today, or I want the glory to go to God. God examines the heart. That's what David tells us. But not only does God examine the heart, God touches the heart. Back in chapter 10, I found a little verse here this past week, and I said, Lord, this is such a sweet verse. 1 Samuel 10, verse 26. And Saul also went home to Gibeah, and there went with him a band of men whose hearts God had touched. Has your heart ever been touched by God? You see, when God examines the heart, then God touches the heart if we don't push his hand away. And I really do believe that in any given service, that God Almighty, through the person and the power and the personality of the Holy Spirit, reaches out and touches hearts that he is examining. And so many times we just push God's hand away. But when God examines that heart, and if God sees fear, if we'll let him, he will touch it and replace it with faith. When God examines the heart, if he sees doubt, if we will let him touch our heart, then he will replace it with certainty. When God examines the heart, if he sees sin, if we will not push that hand away and we will repent, God will touch that heart and he will forgive it. When God examines the heart, if he sees lukewarmness and we'll not push his hand away, he will set our heart on fire for himself. Friend, don't push his hand away. I want to tell you what, the most dangerous condition anybody could ever be in as a saved person is to come to church Sunday after Sunday after Sunday, and all God ever does is touch their head and never touches their heart. Friend, I'm not interested in God just touching my head. I want him to touch my heart. Because not only does he examine the heart and touch the heart, he also changes the heart. And it's a sad situation to get in a position where we feel like our hearts do not need to be changed. They do. There's not a person in here today that doesn't need a change of heart in some area. God touches our heart, changes our aspirations, our ambitions, our desires. But if we'll let him, man, he'll touch our heart. I'm speaking to some right now. Your heart is so cold, so indifferent, so lifeless. And you're sick of it. You're absolutely sick of it. Because you can remember what it was like when your heart was hot for God. But it's not that way anymore. And you need God to touch it and God to change it. And those are the kinds of people that God's looking for today. You know, if you and I would have been alive as Jews back in 1020 BC, man, all of our attention would have been focused on Saul. He was the mover and shaker. He was the important dude in town. But God had his eye on a little nobody that nobody else noticed, out in a nowhere place. And he said, I see something in his heart, and I can use him for my glory. God sees your heart too. Seeing that some of you have never been saved, and he is touching your heart today, calling you to salvation. That some of you have such potential, and he is touching your heart today to yield to him that he might use you. What good is it to live and die and never glorify God to our uppermost potential? What a waste that is. God's touching some of your hearts and saying, you know what? I got a place of service for you right here at First Baptist, but you need to join this church so I can use you. God's speaking to your heart as well. Would you stand, please? Heads bowed and eyes closed. And Father, we thank you that even today, that you are selecting those to live like kings. God, I pray that we would not settle for anything less, that our heart's desire would be to be like David, to have a faithful heart, a humble heart, a worshiping heart, a serving heart, a forgiven heart. And I pray that we would yield to your lordship today and allow that to take place. I pray for those decisions that need to be made, that God, they would be this day. I pray that those who need to come would not wait on someone else to respond, that immediately they would begin to make their way to the front. God, do a work, I pray today, in our hearts, in Jesus' name. Heads are bowed and eyes closed. No one...